On behalf of Richard and Matthew, I welcome you in joining them to celebrate the life of their dad, Eric Stanley Evans, and to remember with happiness the laughter, travels, rounds of golf, and other special times or events you shared with Eric during his lifetime. It's wonderful to have so many of you here today. Old friends from Hereford, where Eric grew up, friends and neighbours from Ulster, where he enjoyed family and married life with Janet, Rich and Matt, golfing buddies, fellow Masons, new friends he's met since embracing coach trips to new places, and his siblings, David, Wendy and Flora. Thanks to each of you for being here today. I first met Eric 30 years ago. Rich and I had become great friends at university, and I spent a few days in Roman Way meeting the Evans family and being introduced to their warm welcome, love of cats and passion for games. I was also introduced to Eric's sense of fun and mischief, learning to be on my toes in response to his quick wit and one-liners, and learning more about cattle than I ever imagined that I would. There was also his beaming smile and raucous laughter, evidenced in some of the wonderful photos you have in your orders of service, and along with Janet's wide smile, characteristics inherited by both Rich and Matt. Today's celebration will continue with the Lord's Prayer before we hear more about Eric's life from his brother David and his son Matt. Please stand and join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. We'll now hear from David and Matt.
Eric Stanley Evans. My brother Eric was born on the 3rd of June 1944 and grew up on the family farm, Rollsford Muckett in the Wye Valley in Herefordshire, as did myself and my sister Flora and Wendy. Rollsford was a small 100-acre mixed farm of sheep, cattle, milking cows and arable, and basically self-sufficient. How did we all survive with no mains water, electric or telephone? Looking back, those times must have been exceptionally challenging for our mother. Life was particularly hard for Eric, as being the eldest, he missed out on a large part of his academic schooling because of having to work on the farm from an early age. We both started milking cows at the age of 10 and driving tractors at much the same time. Eric became more and more adept at taking over many family chores. Our father rented land some 3 miles from the farm, which often meant Eric and myself driving sheep along the road to those fields on foot, with father on a tractor following behind. It was then back to do the milking by hand, and all this before catching the school bus at 8 a.m. Eric learned to ride, but not on a horse, but on a pet milking cow called Ben. He later became an accomplished horse rider, this time with reins and a saddle. When aged 17, Eric was legally allowed to drive on the road, and he became involved with Eardsley Young Farmers, where he learnt to dance very well, as it turned out, and not afraid to escort the beauty queens around the local Young Farmers Club dances. Our small home farm became commercially unviable, and when Eric was around 19, Father decided to sell up and retire. This upset Eric enormously, as he was a born farmer and loved the cattle. But after seeing through the farm sale, including his livestock, he joined Avoncroft Cattle Breeders based in Bromsgrove, hence the move to Ulster. He trained to become an artificial inseminator of milking cows and was exceptionally good at it. He often returned to Herefordshire to cover for holidays and other breeding centres, which he really enjoyed. He was very well known and highly respected by the farms he visited. Later training, many farmers in Herefordshire and surrounding areas in the art of DIY insemination. I'll now let the boys take over from Ulster.
Dad's life changed in the late 60s when he helped guide a pony trekking weekend in the Welsh Brecon Beacons. This is where he met Janice Lacey, who was also a guide. He won her over with his flashy riding, and soon they were writing love letters to each other and meeting up whenever they could. We only found out about the love letters a couple of weeks ago when we found them in an envelope on his bedside table. We never knew that Dad was such a romantic. Eric and Janet married on the 5th of April, 1969, in Loughborough, and moved to Ulster, which would be their home for the next 50 years. After 5 years of trying for a baby, on the 21st of June, 1974, Richard was born. And 5 years later, on the 22nd of June, 1979, so was I. A happy accident, we found out from reading Mum's memoirs. As we grew up, we all had many happy memories of get-togethers with friends, June, Bob, Sheila and Roy, and their families. We all used to look forward to boozy game sessions each Boxing Day. Some of our earliest memories of going on canal boat holidays. One such memory, when Dad had had a couple of drinks, he told me that I should feel very much at home on a canal boat, as that is where I had been conceived. For family summer holidays, we used to fill the car and the trailer and headed to either Jersey or a seaside town such as Swanage or Watergate Bay and set up base camp in our big orange house tent. We were the best equipped beachgoers. Each day we would carry with us a metric ton of windbreaks, surfboards and picnic items. Dad also liked to get away on his own. He loved to drive, and even though he didn't strictly have an HGV license, he would go away for weeks as the second man with a local long-haul truck driver he knew. We would be excited for his return, as he would always bring with him a goodie bag full of confectionery and Spanish knickknacks. When we were growing up, Dad's job at Avoncroft proved highly entertaining for a pair of young boys. We would often find ourselves tagging along with him, playing in the fields with the cows, bunking off school to go with Dad to the Royal Show, driving in the van with him, all being allowed to play with the huge vats of liquid nitrogen, which were such a big part of Dad's job. For a while, Dad also had a side gig working at Savoury & Moore Chemists. He mainly worked in the storeroom, but Richard recalls him coming home with particularly red rosy cheeks at Christmas time, when he visited the shop to meet Santa, finding that the fat beardy man there seemed somehow strangely familiar. After many years of service, Dad left Avoncroft and went and worked for DEFRA as a lab assistant, helping them to do autopsies on animals in order to monitor outbreaks of foot and mouth, BSE and the like. On one occasion, I remember Mum going off to the chest freezer in the garage and started screaming. Dad and I ran in to find out what was wrong, and she was staring at a whole sheep carcass that Dad had brought home with him from work. He very reasonably tried to explain that there wasn't any disease and that it would be a shame for it to go to waste. Upon his retirement, Dad was looking forward to enjoying his later years holidaying with Mum and pottering around the garden. Unfortunately, the focus of his time gradually shifted to taking care of Mum in her later years. This was a labour of love, and he entered into this wholeheartedly. Dad was heartbroken at Mum's parting and soldiered on in isolation at home during COVID. As restrictions lifted, he was able to get back out into the world and enjoyed going on coach holidays around the British Isles. On one of these trips, he met a new friend, Elaine. He introduced Elaine to us at Christmas, and we all had a wonderful time together. It was great to see him so happy. Dad's health sadly declined soon after. Richard relocated from London, and we were able to spend lots of time with him in Roman Way, and then on daily visits to Coventry Hospital before he unfortunately passed away. Over the last few weeks, many people have told us and come to us and expressed their sadness at Dad's passing and telling us what a well-loved character he was. And these are some of the facets of his character that come to mind when Richard and I think of him. Dad was community-minded. Dad served as a special constable for 14 years, winning several awards. Years later, I followed him into the force, and I remember him and Mum dropping me off for my first day of training at my police station house. I remember him suddenly becoming very happy when he saw the room that I would be staying in for my first few years in the force. Room 301. He explained that that had been his collar number when he'd been a police for all those 14 years. It felt like the baton had been passed. For many years, most Saturdays, Dad would visit an elderly German lady in Aston Cantlow. She didn't have any close family of her own, and so he would go by to help out with little jobs around the house, mowing the lawns, and so on and so forth. And occasionally, I was deposited at her house for an evening or so when Mum and Dad would go out partying. I distinctly remember being terrified by a scary crocheted clown that she would put at the end of my bed. Dad was an accomplished sportsman. Dad was an excellent shot. He enjoyed clay pigeon shooting and was part of the successful Mason's Arms Bell Target Shooting Air Rifle Team. That's right, shooting inside a pub. On one occasion, they were short of a team member and I got drafted. As a 14-year-old, I had no experience at that time of doing shots down the pub. I had, however, been plinking with our BSA Meteor air rifle at the bottom of the garden, which must have stood me in some good stead because our team won. Dad played skittles, bowls, and enjoyed loving playing golf. Over the years, he won many prizes, and we started to wonder if his handicap was perhaps a little too high. In his later life, he was an active member of the Broadway Golf Club, playing as part of the optimistically titled Coffin Dodgers. Dad was full of good advice. When I had just passed my driving test, I was home with Mum and Dad and I had an early shift the following morning, and so I planned to drive back in the early hours. However, overnight, it was destined to be heavy snowfall. So Dad reminded me to drive slowly, knowing that I suffered from a very heavy foot. Later at 5 a.m, as everybody else slept, I got up to drive to work, driving down the dual carriageways that led to Birmingham in the virgin snow at what I thought was a very sensible 45 miles an hour. My Ford Fiesta finally came to rest, having smashed into the central reservation and spun around three times. I managed to get out of the car and immediately rang Dad. He picked up the phone straight away without me even having to introduce myself and stated, "Are you all right? And how bad is the damage?" He knew me too well. Given that Dad had spent much of his career getting cows pregnant, there wasn't much he didn't know about the birds and the bees. For me, the talk happened when we were driving to a party after school. With no build-up or explanation, he simply stated out of the blue, "Always wear a welly." This confused me, as I regularly wore wellies as we to go up the garden when it was muddy, and I had absolutely no idea why I should be doing this on a night out with my friends. And this phrase remained a mystery to me for several years, until later when Richard and I were going out clubbing, and nonchalantly he asked me if I had remembered to bring my wellies. And we realised at that moment that we had both had the same cryptic sex education in our formative years. Dad was understanding. One day, a 17-year-old Richard was trying to get his motorcycle out of the garage, but he couldn't open the doors as Dad had parked his car too close. Despite not having a suitable driving licence himself, nor any real experience driving a car, Dad thought that he would simply back the car up the slope of the drive just a touch. He selected the wrong gear and the car lurched forwards, embedding itself into the garage doors. After gathering himself, he made a very nervous phone call to Dad, explaining the situation. And despite the extensive damage to the garage and to the car, Dad never lost his temper and somehow managed to explain the scratches away when he was getting a replacement company car. Dad liked to play by his own rules. When I was 15, Dad caught me sneaking into the house with some cider that I had bought. He asked me, "Where did you get that from?" I sheepishly told him the name of the off-license, and he looked rather annoyed and set off down the town. I assumed he was going to go and have a few harsh words with the shopkeeper. However, he returned with yet more cider, explaining, "You can't buy booze underage. You're going to get that poor man in trouble." In 1989, I remember being desperate to see the latest Tim Burton Batman movie. As we went to the cinema, the man behind the desk selling the tickets asked how old I was. I replied, "I am 9, because I was an honest boy. He explained that the film was a 12 certificate, so I wouldn't be allowed to go in. Hearing this, Dad slipped him a £10 note stating, "Looks 12 to me," and we walked into the film. Dad encouraged us to be our own men. Dad was never afraid of letting us live adventurously. He constructed a rope swing off a tree overhanging the railway cutting at the bottom of the garden, and Richard and I would spend hours swinging out over the chasm. And on one particular occasion, Richard and the swing parted company, and he was rushed to hospital for stitches. However, despite its proven danger factor, the swing remained as a reminder that we should hold on tight in life. When Richard moved into his house in London, Dad bought him a long brush for the shower, which had "Scrub Your Own Back" emblazoned on it. And Dad was very proud of the home that he helped create for us. We never wanted for anything, and we always knew that if we ever needed to reach out, Dad would be there as a safety net. He once told me that he hoped that if either of us were ever dropped anywhere in the world, that he would have given us the wherewithal to have found our way home. Dad was a larger-than-life character, the likes of which even God has not seen. And his passing leaves a large Dad-shaped hole in our hearts. We will endeavour to live in a way that would make him proud.
Rich is now going to read a poem that Eric sent to both him and Matt. The version you see in the order of service is a photo of the original torn-out hand-amended version that Eric then photocopied and posted to each of his sons. Although Rich and Matt didn't always see the sentimental side of their dad, when it presented itself, it did so in a love-filled and impactful way. Rich has his copy stuck to his fridge in London, and it means a lot to him and Matt to share with you all today these words that their dad sent to them.
Words of wisdom to my sons. I've travelled paths you've yet to walk, learned lessons old and new. And now this wisdom of my life, I'm blessed to share with you. Learn to trust your feelings, your beliefs you should uphold. Don't walk away from what is right. Be courageous and be bold. Keep faith beside you always, it will guide you every day. Know that strength comes from above and you will find your way. Let yourself be humble and remember to be kind. When you have respect for others, true friendships you will find. Have dignity and honour, and be proud of all you do. Confidence will take you toward a future that waits for you. The world is filled with choices. There are challenges to face. But you can make a difference as you find your rightful place. And so, I cannot wait to see the wonders you will do. Because you are my son, and I am so proud of you.
We're now going to have some time to reflect on our own memories of Eric. During this time, you'll hear the Rudyard Kipling poem, If, read and recorded by Des Lynham. It's a poem and version that was shared by Eric with each of his sons one Christmas, when he surprised each of them at the end of dinner with a final gift, individually wrapped and gifted, with an emotion that's memorable to both Rich and Matt. It's a poem that Eric loved.
If you can keep your head when all about you are losing theirs and blaming it on you, if you can trust yourself when all men doubt you, but make allowance for their doubting too. Being lied about, don't deal in lies. Or being hated, don't give way to hating. And yet don't look too good, nor talk too wise. If you can dream, and not make dreams your master. If you can think, and not make thoughts your aim. If you can meet with triumph and disaster, and treat those two impostors just the same. If you can bear to hear the truth you've spoken, twisted by knaves to make a trap for fools, or watch the things you gave your life to, broken, and stoop, and build them up with worn-out tools. talk with crowds and keep your virtue, or walk with kings, nor lose the common touch. If neither foes nor loving friends can hurt you, if all men count with you, but none too much. If you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds worth of distance run, yours is the earth and everything that's in it. And, which is more, you will be a man, my son.
Time for us to say our final farewells to Eric, after which Rich and Matt welcome you to join them both at the King's Court Hotel in Ulster to continue their celebration for their dad's life and to remember Eric with love and thanks for all he meant to each of you. Would you stand now for the committal? Eric Stanley Evans, your life we honour. Your departure we accept. Your memory we cherish. Although there is sadness today as we say goodbye, there is gratitude and appreciation for your life and your role in each of ours. We are grateful for the privilege of having shared life with you. But rest now at the end of your days. Rest in the hearts and minds of all those who love you and share friendship with you. And so with love, we shall leave you in peace. And with respect, we bid you a fond farewell.
Yes, it was mine.